Hello and welcome to this video where we explain how to set up a Synchronicity on-prem storage vault. As a disclaimer, make sure you always use the latest material, and especially for the latest storage connectors, 3.x and above, which have been significantly improved on performance and scalability. For an agenda of today, we're going to explain you what an on-prem storage vault is, what the benefits are for you, the architecture, pre-requirements. We're going to walk you through the complete setup of a storage connector and test it and monitor it. In the Synchronicity layered approach, you see that storage and storage vaults are at the lower end of our architecture. That means that any client, no matter where you are, if you are based in a US privacy region or in an EU privacy region, you can access data that is being shared with you either in a public cloud storage or on an on-premise storage vault. So what is an on-prem storage vault? Files in Synchronicity are stored either in Synchronicity's data center, in EU, US, in FedRAMP, or in your local service provider of choice, or in your own data center. It will be a storage policy that will dictate where your files are actually stored. So when you want to upload a file, it's the orchestration that will determine, based on your policy, where to store the file. And then your client will connect directly to that storage vault using the provisioned URL where the storage connector would store the data on your backend storage. The benefits for you are that you can comply with corporate governance, which requires you to have the data on-premise or in your own country or wherever you want it to be, but also for some customers for capacity reasons, because they have huge volumes of data that would not fit in your public cloud subscription. Because data is where you want it to be, you can also opt for an on-prem storage vault to make sure that the data is where it's being used. From an architecture point of view, we distinguish the internet, where our orchestration is, your clients, which can live on either the internal network or the internet, and for customers who want the file stored in their own data center, they need to deploy two or more storage connectors, and they need to put a load balancer with an SSL certificate in front of it. When a user wants to upload a file, the client will calculate a hash of that file and redirect the client to the correct storage connector, who will then receive the file, encrypt it, and store the encrypted data on your backend storage. When the upload is complete, storage connector will write all the important information in the orchestration service in your privacy region. This means that a storage connector is a completely stateless appliance, which requires no monitoring or maintenance, which is good for your total cost of ownership. So hopefully by now you have agreed on how your architecture will look like for setting up your on-prem storage. Let's look at the procedure. Of course, you need a fully qualified domain name for your on-prem storage vault. Get an SSL certificate for it. Make sure that traffic can arrive to the load balancer from the internet or from your clients. Download and deploy the storage connectors and connect the storage connectors to your backend storage. Then, from a Telnet client, we will configure the storage connector, making sure that the storage is accessible. And when all firewall ports are opened, you can configure the storage vault in your admin console and configure the storage connector itself. Once that is done, we will do the tests and set up the storage policies to make sure that data and Synchronicity is stored on your on-prem storage vault. Besides this list, we also have a more detailed project plan, which we'll describe in more detail for each of the items, what is required, and who should perform that action. If you want to get access to that project plan, feel free to contact your local customer success manager. In this video, we're going to set up an on-premise storage vault, which name is SV01. The URL to that storage vault you'll see here, sv01.residencenewland.com. And because on my load balancer, I also need an SSL certificate, in my sample, I'm using a wildcard for that domain. As the backend storage, I will use NFS, and my NFS will be mounted on this particular IP address. Now that we have agreed on the architecture, we have a fully qualified domain name for a storage vault, we have an SSL certificate and configured the load balancer to handle the load, it is now time to download the virtual machine and deploy it in a hypervisor. Navigate to the Synchronicity website and, if required, log in. And under the admin console, under the section Downloads, you'll find the storage connector virtual appliance. Download it, and once it is downloaded, make sure that it is accessible to your vSphere client. Here we're going to deploy the virtual machine template, select the file, open it, and in the wizard, you first give it a new name. Best practice is to work with /_storage_connector name, select the storage location. In my case, I did a thin provision, select a network, and once that is done, you'll let the import wizard importing your machine template into the hypervisor. Okay, this is done. We can now power on the virtual machine, navigate to the console of the appliance, and you can log in with user SyncP, password on-prem. Then you need to change the password into a new password, which is 14 characters, lowercase, uppercase, numerics, and special characters. Confirm it. But once that is done, you can change the password for root. First enter the password for SyncP, of course, change it to a new password. And of course, because you're now root, you can also change the password for SyncP again, if you would like to get a different password than the 14 character passwords that you entered earlier. If you, like me, don't use a QWERTY keyboard, but something else, in the /etcvconsole.conf, you can change the keyboard layout. Press IFM Insert and change the keyboard to your own layout. You see the samples here. Save the file by escape:wq and you're done. As root, navigate to /etc/sysconfig/network scripts and there you find the file ifc.eth0. VI this file, press IFM Insert, change the DNS first. I have only one DNS, so I'll use both. Then you enter the IP address of your machine. I use a fixed IP address, enter a gateway, leave the net mask, and save the changes, escape WQ. We go one folder higher, and there we're going to VI the network file. Press IFM Insert. Change the host name and domain name according to your naming convention, escape WQ to save. One folder higher, you will find resolve.conf, which is already okay for me. My DNS is there. So next, I can check my time zone, which is incorrect for me because it mentions UTC, and I am based in Brussels. So I first search for my time zone. It's somewhere in Europe and I found it's Brussels, so that's fine. I'll set the time zone in the time date CTL set time zone command. And then when I do a check, you see that it is correct. So now my log files will present the correct timestamps. I will reboot the computer now. And once I have rebooted, I can log in again with the user SyncP. I will switch to root, and now I can test my connection to the orchestration. And I see that I get a correct certificate, so it's not being confiscated by a proxy or something. So that means my storage connector can talk to the orchestration. Wow, so we have checked a lot of items on our list. We can now continue with mounting the backend storage, which is NFS. For that, we're going to reconnect using PuTTY or Telnet client. I'm going to save my connection for later usage. With that, I will connect to my storage connector, log in with SyncP, and switch to root. Then in the /etcfstab file, press IFM Insert, add your host name, share name, and mount it to /mnt/syncp. Save this with escape:wq. We boot the machine, and once it is back up, we can check with the command df if the mount was successful. And you see that the mount was successfully mounted to /mnt/syncp. One more item checked on our list. So our next step, we assume that your firewall ports are open. Before we continue with the configuration itself, there's something we want to tell you about a new feature, which is called the Simplicity Keystore file. As you know by now, the storage connector accesses both your backend storage, but also talks to the Simplicity orchestration. To the orchestration, it uses the access key, and if you use S3 as a backend storage, it uses the S3 access key in secret. The storage connector configuration file itself has got good enough security because you need root access, the configuration files are protected and owned by SyncP storage, and there is a separation between config file and log files. However, when your security officer requires more security, or for example, when you're going to apply components which are more communicating to the orchestration service, then you might to consider moving that sensitive data into a protected vault. For example, here you see that the access key and the S3 credentials have been moved to a KeyStore file. That secure vault, that KeyStore file, is then accessed by using a secret file, an AWS provider, or that offers you the highest protection by introducing an HSM solution. When the storage connector boots up, it will retrieve the key from the HSM, accesses the information in the key store, and there it will get the access key to talk to the Simplicity orchestration or to talk to your backend storage or any other sensitive stuff that you don't want into a configuration file like the SyncP storage file. As a best practice, when should you store the information in a configuration file and when to store them in a key store file, it is completely up to you. If you, for example, upgrading from a previous version of your storage connector and you're okay with the access key in the configuration file, then you can continue doing so. Even with the new storage connectors, you don't need to use a key store file. However, if your storage connector is, for example, off-premise in, let's say, Amazon or a service provider, you could consider using the key store to avoid the service provider from seeing your credentials. And the same goes with deploying additional components like search, rights management, DLP, antivirus, or even when you use storage vault authentication, you can still leave connection settings in the configuration file. But when you don't want to store those credentials in that configuration file, you can also move them into that key store file. It is only when you want to deploy customer managed keys, where encryption is being performed by your own encryption key, then you should not store that key in the configuration file, but instead store all sensitive information into the key store file and store the access to the key store file into the HSM solution. This video will concentrate on just configuration of the storage connector without the complexity of a key store file. There is a separate video on how to make your Simplicity storage configuration more secure and moving credentials into a key store file. This video is primarily meant for simple configurations or for those customers who need to upgrade from an old storage connector to a newer version. So if you want to get more information on that key store file and how to use it, how to configure it, how to upgrade to it, that's another video. So let's crack on and configure the new storage vault in the Simplicity admin console. And then we're going to configure the storage connector appliance for this new storage vault. With all the information so far, it's not that difficult to configure the file. Navigate to the SyncP storage folder and vi the YML file. In the configuration file, we need to do three things. We need to uncomment the access key. We need to specify the storage, and we also need to specify where the chunks will be stored. The access key can be retrieved from the admin console, but we first need to create that storage vault, of course. Scroll down under Settings to Manage Storage Vaults and click on Add Storage Vault. Give your storage vault a name that corresponds to your naming convention for storage vaults, and give it also a detailed description of what the storage vault does, what purposes it is, or what department it will be used for. Specify also how much storage you have foreseen in the backend for it, and of course this must be less or equal as what you enter here. Scroll a bit more down, where you will find the URL for your storage connectors. That will be, of course, the fully qualified domain name of your storage vault, and the traffic will arrive via the load balancer on port 9000 to the storage connectors. We're going to save this setting in the admin console, and now the access key is generated. We just need to retrieve it. So click again on your storage vault and copy the access key to your clipboard. Maybe also save it to a safe location. We're going back to our storage connector configuration file. Press I for insert, uncomment the access key, and paste it here. Very simple. Now, if you are using an orchestration service in Europe, don't forget to also uncomment the URLs to the European orchestration. So that is the URL for XML, the API, and also the health at the bottom of the page that you need to adopt. We specify the file system as NFS, and we also specify here a bit below where our mount point exactly is. It's in the /MNT/SyncP. As we already mentioned that we're not going to use the key store, we're going to scroll down, and where you find the section of the key store, we set that to false. That's it. I'm going to scroll down a little bit where you see again that reference to the health site if you would need to use orchestration in Europe. Let's save the file by escape colon WQ. So we can now move to our next step, test the storage connector. Well, there is one more thing to do. We need to make sure that SyncP Storage owns the backend storage. So therefore, we go back to our storage connector and we execute the command chain own on the mount point slash mnt slash SyncP. With that, and this command can take a while, we know that the storage connector owns all the files in that folder. So if I create a test folder and I go back, I see that SyncP Storage now owns the folder. We can now start the service, which starts successfully, but we want to give you an additional tip. If you want to test if your connection works from outside, then the best way to test this is with a site like this, where you enter the URL for your storage vault and you click submit. I get a successful connection, which means that the entire connection from a client to my storage connector works. As a global admin, you can now create a test folder by navigating to a user account. I'm going to search for Bob Sync. Scroll down to the personal folders and click on manage. And scroll down all the way down where you can create a new folder for that particular user. I'm going to call it My Storage Vault Test. I'm going to select SV01 as my target. Save. You see here the folder. Now, don't forget to save again. And now your folder is created. We can now test to upload a file. I'm going to choose a 30 megabyte video file, which I can select. And we see that the transfer starts, the transfer completes, and it looks like it is successful. So now we can try to download the file, for example, stream the video file in the browser, and that works as well. So with that, I can confirm now that my storage connector is able to upload and download files. I can also do the testing with my desktop client, which I have installed. Click on Manage Folders, select the folder you want to sync, add it to the device, and change location if you want to sync it to a particular location on your computer, which will be here, the My Projects folder. In order to show how the syncing works on my desktop client, I'm going to sync the folder to my computer. I'm also going to open another window where I have a video file, and I also open the trace window of Syncplicity. When I then drag and drop a file into the synced folder, the desktop client immediately starts syncing the file. It reaches out to my storage vault on the URL that you see here. And then the desktop client uploads every chunk of 5 megabyte to the storage connector. When the file is completed, the desktop client will mark the file with a green check mark. The upload from the desktop client works, so another item for my checklist. Now we can set up the storage set policy. As an administrator, browse to My Syncplicity and under admin, click on policies, then storage sets. If you have already a bunch of policies defined, that's okay. If not, there is one storage policy which today points to your default, which is for me, my cloud storage in EU. You have two options. You either switch that to your new storage vault that you created, and then all the folders will be created here under this new storage vault. Or if you have already a bunch of storage policies defined, you can navigate to one of those and change that policy to now use that storage vault that you just created, SV01. Because you can have multiple storage policies, you can assign a storage policy per group of users. So for example, my employees will use an on-prem storage, but my marketing team, because they create so large videos, I can decide that they will store their videos on a public cloud storage. We have changed the storage policy for Bob Sync, who is part of the executives group. So let's test this. Create a folder in my SV01 test policy, and in that folder, simply add another Excel file to it. When the file is created and we add the folder to Syncplicity, we see that the folder is starting to sync. We see in the trace window that the file was successfully stored on my storage vault URL, and the file is synced there as well. I can now navigate to the admin console, search for the folder SV01 test. Not only does the folder exist, but we see that it is also stored on my on-prem storage vault. So what did we do today? We have shown you the architecture. We've explained to you how the architecture works for an on-premise storage vault, explained you about the URL and that SSL certificate that you need, the importance of a load balancer, and then we really demoed how you download the OVA and install it on your hypervisor. We have logged in, changed the password for SyncP and root. We have connected the storage connector to your network. Then using PuTTY, we could connect to the storage connector and from there change the fstab file to mount the backend storage. Make sure that SyncP storage was the owner of all the files. We have not done this today, but we assumed that firewall ports were opened. We also showed you how you can check this with the OpenSSL command. We then configured the new storage vault in the admin console of Synplicity and took the access key. We then configured the YML file with the access key. And we have pointed the storage connector to the file system, tested this. And finally, we also configured the storage set policy to make sure that files were written on your backend storage. So this storage vault is now set up with one storage connector, but you can clone this storage connector to your secondary storage connector, or you just set up the storage connector in a similar way as you did your first one. On our agenda, there's one more item to discuss, and that is monitoring. And we also would like to tell you a little bit more on how to upgrade storage connectors from old generation to the newer generations. Monitoring storage vaults can be done very simple by using a browser and connecting via that browser to the storage connector's IP address on port 9000 and give the ping URL, that's how we call it. So this is my storage connector IP address /ping, and it would give these magical four letters back as a response. So with that, I know that my storage connector is working. Some load balancers use that technique to find out if the storage vault is actually operational. Of course, you can also integrate with a solution like Grafana or Splunk or any other management system. You see here a screenshot of a very simple configuration in Splunk where we identify the loads, the uploads and downloads that were performed to a specific storage vault. Not very visible here on the screen, but here you see the different IP addresses and the load that each machine got. More information can be found on our website. There is an article how to set up the integration with, for example, Splunk or Grafana. But it also helps you to, for example, to find out the health of the storage connector. So far, we explained how you would install a new storage vault with brand new storage connectors. But what if you have already an existing infrastructure? In the drawing on the right, you see that when you upload a file, the client connects to one of the available storage connectors and the file gets stored on your backend storage. In order to perform an upgrade, you would download two new machine templates, the so-called OVA files, and deploy them as new additional nodes in your infrastructure. You can take the settings from the old storage connectors, the access key, NFS mount, or S3 credentials, and enter these in the new configuration file. Note that we are now using a YML file instead of a conf file, so you cannot copy the file from the old node to the new nodes. Once you've configured your new nodes, you can start them and test them. If your load balancer admin can isolate these storage connectors from the production users, then that's even better. And at the end, when everything works fine, you simply remove the older storage connectors and configure your load balancer to point all traffic to the new storage connectors. When you are upgrading from an old storage connector to a new one, you might be encountering an issue with the UID and Git. This causes that the new storage connectors can no longer access the backend storage. And we're going to help you to solve that problem. One way to solve this is our recommended approach, but it requires some downtime. You stop the service, you change the UID and Git to accommodate the new storage connector. You also change the ownership of all the log files and the startup scripts. And once that is done, you can compare the old storage connector with the new storage connector and see if they match up together. This requires downtime, however, depending on how much storage needs to be changed ownership. So we'll start by stopping the service. Let's view the IDs, which is 498 and 499. Change the UID to 996 and change the group ID to 994. when we review that again, we see that it is indeed changed. We now change the ownership of the log file directory. We change the ownership of the library, the runtimes. And then this is what takes the most of our time, changing the ownership of the storage. That can take up to hours, maybe even a day. So take your time to change that ownership. But once that is completed, you'll see that in both the old and the new storage connector, SyncP Storage now owns the backend storage. And that is what we need. The other approach, if you're not having the luxury of having some planned downtime, you can change the UID and Git of the new storage connector to accommodate the old storage connector. With that, you of course need to make sure that you make that change with every new storage connector that you deploy, or at one moment you make the change so it will accommodate to the new standards. So this time we will make the change on the new storage connector. We stop the service, and by checking the IDs, you see that these are the IDs for the new storage connectors. We're going to change the UID and Git to accommodate the old storage connector. Let's run a test to see if that works. That's fine. Then we can change the ownership of both the log file, the library file. So yeah, that should be library instead, my bad. And we also need to restart the service. We don't need to change the ownership of the backend storage. So when we check, we see that both on the new storage connector and the old storage connector, the storage is owned by SyncP Storage. And that's what we wanted. So with that, as a bonus, we have covered the upgrade from an old storage connector to the 3.x storage connectors. Don't forget that there is always help available on our website, docs.axway.com. There are entire sections on how to upgrade your on-prem storage connectors. So all the latest information, you can always find that here. With that, I would like to thank you for your attention and hope to hear from you soon. Thank you and bye-bye.